Hello, everybody, and welcome to what I'm sure is going to be a really fascinating discussion about Golda, Maia, the woman, the documentary. We've got a great panel lined up. I will wait for Bev Goldman to introduce everybody. We're just going to wait a couple of minutes to let some more people in, and we'll be starting soon. Thank you for joining us. Okay, everybody, welcome, a hearty welcome to this fascinating discussion on Golda Meir, the movie, the documentary, the woman, with our fantastic panel. Without any further ado, I'd like to hand you over to our host for the evening, Bev Goldman.
Thank you, David, and good evening to everyone, and thank you for joining what promises to be a most fascinating and intriguing discussion with three remarkable panelists, all of them to a certain degree or other intimately involved or somehow well acquainted with Israel's most extraordinary woman, and certainly for the first few years of her tenure, a quintessential leader. However, as I watched awestruck as the history of her time in office unfolded, I couldn't help remembering, with apologies to Shakespeare for the slight change in wording, that all too often saying of his, and I quote, "The errors that men do live after them. The good is oft interred with their bones." That, I think, really quantifies the memories so many Israelis have of Golda. She was truly a woman of worth, a woman of great intellect, passion, principle to an extreme. And yet the legacy she left behind her is surely not one she would have chosen for herself. Golda has been described as seemingly indestructible, but she was a wife, a mother, a grandmother. And if she came across as rigid and inflexible, I suggest that it didn't reflect as much on her personality as it did on her upbringing, her childhood, and ultimately the position she held as Prime Minister. But we'll hear more about that from Professor Medzini. This being Women's Month, the South African Zionist Federation took a decision to present the spellbinding, mesmerizing documentary, simply entitled Golda, as the closing event of this very significant, yet far too often marginalized time in society. Although COVID has created a dysfunctional, maladjusted, and almost disabled society to replace the normality we once experienced, it was still felt a fitting time to highlight this remarkable woman whose impact upon Israeli society has been and will be felt for decades, both past and future. I will be asking each of the panelists a number of questions, and this will be followed by a Q&A from you, the audience. Please think carefully about the questions you're going to ask, and I will then pass each question on to the relevant panelist. Please do ask questions, and in order to do so, there's a chat button at the bottom of your screens. Simply click on the button and type in both your question and which panelist you're targeting for the answer. All the panelists are keen to interact with the audience and to get an idea of how you saw Golda, how you responded to the documentary, and anything else germane to the discussion. Before we start, there's a short introductory trailer of the documentary. David?
Just one sec.
What's that kind of shaman? Can this child give me a...
אבל הייתה יכולה להיות גם קרה ודי אכזרית לפעמים.
יש לי כל כך הרבה צערות אמיתיות שאינני מוכנה למה היה אילו.
גולדה אישרה לי דברים שאני לא אחזור אליהם גם אם תקרצי לי בעיניים ותחייכי לי.
לא מפני שזה נעים לי, אין ברירה.
כל התסביכים היהודיים היו בה.
זה שקר אם אומרים שלא יכפת אם נהיה רוב או נהיה מיעוט. אנחנו כולנו פלסטינאים. לא, יש לי הפספורט הישן.
איזה דבר מטומטם זה.
לצערי, היו שסילפו את דמותה.
אני המלכה של העם היהודי, וגם היום.
היא לא הבינה את הכאב, את הכעס.
כמו שהיא עלתה ביום אחד, כך התקמצנך.
היה נורא.
אף אחד לא חי.
אי אפשר לדעת כאילו מחשבות חלפות במך.
היא הבינה שזה נגמר.
Thank you, David. And for those of you who may not have watched Golda, please do. It really is a spellbinding documentary. It is completely outstanding. And I think even those of us who watched it have learned things about Golda that we really didn't know. I'll briefly introduce the panelists. We have three, as I said, superb panelists. And they are in alphabetical order, but please note that the woman comes first, which I feel is quite applicable this evening. First of all, we have Gusti Yehoshua Braverman, Head of Diaspora Affairs at the World Zionist Organization. Then we have Professor Emeritus Merod Medzini, the former spokesperson to Golda in the 1970s. And finally, Udi Nir, writer, producer, and director of the Golda documentary. Holding a BA in social work and an MA in communications, both from the Hebrew University, and a certificate of organizational consulting from Tel Aviv University, Gusti is a member, and please note, one of only two women, of the World Zionist Executive, a member of the Jewish Agency Board of Governors, BOG, and chair of the Small Jewish Communities Committee in the Board of Governors. In addition, she serves on Ayelet, the Federation of Non-Olympic Sport in Israel. She is a board member of Ladat, or Choose Well, the Organization for the Promotion of Sexual Health and Education, and she's also a member of the board of Kehilat Mevaseret Zion, Kamatz, of the Israel Movement for Reform and Progressive Judaism. With all of this, she has still managed to raise three lovely children with her husband, Yoram. Gusti is on this panel because she is an ardent Zionist, which is what Golda was, a feminist, but not in the sense of a bra-burning vixen, rather a woman determined to bring gender equality to Israel. Our next panelist is Professor Merod Medzini, who holds an MA from Georgetown University in Washington, D.C., and a PhD in Asian Studies from Harvard University. He served for 17 years in the office of the Prime Minister as the director of the Israel Government Press Office in Jerusalem. And in that capacity, he was spokesman for Prime Ministers Levi Eshkol from 1966 to 1969, Golda Meir from 1973-1974, and Yitzhak Rabin 1974-1975. Between 1978 and 1995, he served in senior capacities in Keren HaYesod, the Israel United Appeal, and for many years he headed the English-speaking countries division while also teaching at the Rothberg International School of the Hebrew University. His biography of Golda Meir won the Prime Minister's Award in 2010 and was translated to English. His book on, quote, Japan and the Jews during the Holocaust era was recently published in Japanese. I am going to ask Professor Medzini questions in English. I hope he doesn't reply in Japanese because it could make me feel rather awkward. I wouldn't know if he was answering or not. Professor Medzini had a very close relationship with Golda and can talk with absolute expertise on her personality, both in and out of office. And a frequent visitor to South Africa, Meron has 4 children and 10 grandchildren. And finally, but certainly not least, Udi Nir is a director, is a writer, director, and producer, and he lives in Haifa, one of my favorite cities in Israel. His first feature documentary was Uploading Holocaust, and it was followed by Golda in 2019. Udi studied at the School of Playwriting in Tel Aviv. He created and directed theater shows and worked as a producer at Clipper Theater. Is that how you pronounce it? Clipper. Before turning to arts, Udi worked for Amnesty International and other human rights NGOs. His relationship with Golda, such as it was, stems from the remarkable documentary we've all watched. And that leads me to the first question I have tonight, and that is for you, Udi. And welcome all the way from America. Udi, we're very privileged to have you with us tonight to talk about this extraordinary documentary that has captivated audiences and consolidated people's views of Golda, whether positive or negative or a combination of both. This is the question that I'm sure is the one for which most people would like an answer, and it is, what motivated you to do this documentary on Golda Meir?
Thank you very much for having me. Hello, everyone. It was actually a pretty unusual process for us. Usually we start a film, we start a production from a very deep interest and connection that we already have to the subject matter or the character in the center of the film. And in this case, it was quite unique. We got a phone call roughly 4 years ago from our partners in Germany who knew us from a previous project. And they asked us to create, it was back then, it was right before Israel's 70th anniversary, and they asked us to produce for Arte, the French-German public broadcaster, a short biographical film about Golda Meir. Our initial response, when I talk about us, I'm talking about me and my partner, Sagi Bornstein, and later on, we were also joined by the third director of this project, Shani Rosanes. All three of us were born long after Golda's death. We didn't live through the time, and it was not very much in our minds, I would say. A couple of years ago, I didn't think that there's any chance I would be doing a film about Golda. So our initial response was, why? Why Golda, and why now after so many years? And why us, who were all born after she passed away and didn't live through the time? But two things became clear very quickly. One was that there is such a huge gap in how Golda is perceived in Israel and elsewhere. Our German partners, and later on, we also had partners in the United States, where it's even, the gap is even bigger in that respect. They all told us that Golda is a feminist icon, that she's one of the most familiar faces of Zionism and of Israel throughout history, that in some ways she stands together with Ben-Gurion as maybe the two, you know, parents of the nation in a way. And there couldn't be something further from that in how Golda is remembered in Israel. In Israel, she's a synonym mostly. I mean, of course it varies, and some people think about her differently, but by large, she's considered a sort of synonym for failure and disgrace, and of course mainly remembered for the 1973 Yom Kippur War, and in general has a very negative legacy, I would say. And that gap between how she's perceived in Israel, in her own homeland, and how she's perceived elsewhere in the world fascinated us, because we were sure that there must be some things that Jews and also non-Jews around the world are missing about Golda's stories, where when they have this kind of idealization of her. And there also must be things that we as Israelis are missing about her story and about her character. And we wanted to sort of consolidate these two legacies. That was the first thing. And briefly, just the second thing was, again, we didn't live through the time. And one of the first things that we did was to open a book that contains all the newspaper headlines from these years, 1969 to 1974. And we were just fascinated with how dramatically condensed, I would say, these years were, and how crucial they were in turnouts of history in Israel, in the Middle East, and in the world in general. And basically every conflict that defines our lives in this place until today, every conflict like that has either was either born during those crucial years, or I would say celebrated its bar mitzvah there, or had some kind of culmination at that moment. So it was a fascinating time to dive into, and I think it also sheds light on modern day Israel.
I think that's fabulous, Udi. I think it's wonderful, because to get young people actually to do historical documentaries on the other gender, which shouldn't really matter, but to have produced something so eye-catching, so splendid, and so gripping, really, I mean, I pay huge tribute to the three of you. I think it's just superb. My second question for you, where did you source all the material you have in the documentary? How easy was it accessing the archives? And did you encounter any resistance from those who are the guardians of Israel's history?
There's also an unusual story there. I would say I'll start from the end. So regarding resistance, I don't think there was much resistance. There are still some things from that era that haven't been published. We applied for that many times, but it's really a matter of the law in Israel, because not enough years have passed so far to expose some of the materials from that time. I don't think that there's anything super surprising or crucial in the classified materials that we don't know about, but not much resistance. Israeli archives are pretty accessible, I would say. Most of the footage for the film came from the Israeli television archive, which is a remarkable place. I think it's anything you could expect from an Israeli archive, in that it's disorganized, nothing is properly cataloged, nothing is properly saved in a way, but it's also wonderful and full of surprises and unexpected. So it's a beautiful and interesting place. And the unique story we had was that we basically finished more or less editing the documentary something like 2 years into the production. We already had a cut of the film that was ready for broadcast. And right before sending it to the broadcaster, we were missing some last shots to cover some inserts in the film, some people talking. We needed some shots of Golda going out of the car, into the car, general things like that to cover some of the sound. And we went for one last trip in the crazy and remarkable Israeli TV archive in Jerusalem, just to look for these few specific shots. And when we got there, the manager of the archive told us that, I know you're doing a film about Golda, and we just found that they've just been moving from one place to another place physically, and they found a box that said, an old carton box that was lying on the floor for years, that said Golda. And inside that box, there were two tapes in a very old format called U-matic. It's even older than VHS. It doesn't really exist anymore. And even the archive itself didn't have the machinery, the pieces of equipment to be able to read that old format tapes. And they told us, we can't let you watch it here. We don't know what's inside. It's uncatalogued, but it says Golda. So if you want, you can take it, pay on your own expense, and convert it somewhere else, and let's see what's in there. We're very happy in retrospect that we chose to take that gamble and convert the tapes outside, because when they returned a week later, the first thing we saw was Golda lighting a cigarette. Which in itself is not a, remarkable thing, of course. She smoked a couple of packs of unfiltered cigarettes a day for most of her life. But even back then in the late 70s, it wasn't considered proper for an Israeli former prime minister to be smoking on live television. And so we realized that this material is unique because we're not used to seeing her smoking on TV here. And then when we kept watching it, we basically realized that what we're watching is 25 minutes of unedited and unaired sort of informal conversation between Golda and the two interviewers at the end of a TV show that was recorded just a few months before she passed away. So really an unbelievable catch or like a documentary miracle in a way. But mind you, this was when we were already ready for broadcast. The production was over. We had no more money, no more time. But once we saw the material and realized how incredible it is and how sincere and personal Golda is in it, we just knew that we had to delay the broadcasting, push all our partners away for a while, invest the money we didn't have anymore, and just go for an adventure for an extra year. And the next year was spent re-editing the whole film in light of that material, which now, as you saw, those of you who saw the film, stands at the base of each chapter of the film, and I think really defined what we were able to do in this film.
I just think it was astounding. You know, when it came on and it said it would never before been aired, and I thought, I wonder if the Israeli government is going to come down on you with like a ton of bricks once you've aired. You know, it was quite interesting given the fact that, you know, of who she was and what her background was, but obviously not. I've just had a comment, a question from someone. Could I request people to turn off their video at the bottom of the screen because it's very disturbing? I'm not quite sure what that means, but I have put that request through. Another question for you now, please, Rudi. Golda's life, while extraordinary, was not without pain or controversy. Do you think you captured those contradictions in the documentary?
I think that was definitely our goal. I think in many ways, judging by the reactions to the film, we succeeded, I think. That's really for the audience to judge, but I can tell you a little bit about the reaction to the film because we thought that that was fascinating. When the film first premiered in Israel just over a year ago in the Doc Aviv Film Festival in Tel Aviv, the reactions after the first few screenings, whether people liked it or not, everybody agreed that the film was, I would say, quite soft towards Golda. Or some people use the word soft, others use the word forgiving, but it was a consensus, I think, that the film was more inclined to show Golda in a positive light than people in Israel were used to before. Not without criticism. I think the film has a lot of criticism towards Golda, but again, here in Israel, the reaction was that it's quite soft towards her. And then a few months after that, we went to the United States to attend some festivals where the film was screened there. And in the first one in San Francisco, a member of the audience got up at the end of the screening and said, "I really liked the film. Thank you. It's great. I only have one question that bothers me. What did Golda ever do wrong to you? Why are you so harsh on her in this film?" And I thought that was a remarkable example of first the gap that I was talking about between how she's perceived, but also how really every person can take, or I think every person who watches the film, most of them at least, are confronted with some new information and some new tone towards Golda. And I think that really helps create a more layered or complexed view or character of her.
Well, as I have said a number of times, an extraordinary documentary. And has it had a final question for you? Has it had a long-term emotional effect on you at all?
Oh, absolutely. It was it has to do with many different things. And it was a very long process, as I said before. I mean, overall, it took almost 4 years to complete or 3.5 and a year and a half more than we planned for. So it was really a sort of artistic suicide for us. But we are very happy for it. And I think that I have to honestly say that when I started this project, I started it not hating Golda or disliking her, but very heavy-hearted towards her. Mm. I don't have the trauma of the Yom Kippur War because I didn't live through that time. My parents absolutely do. My father fought that war, and I know the stories, but it wasn't really emotional for me on that respect. I just found her to be old and rigid and sort of unforgiving in her tone, and maybe not with the same world views as I would have liked to seen in the government. But after going through this process, I can't say that I fell in love with her, and I still have a lot of criticism towards her, but I definitely also have a lot of respect for her. And that respect, and I still disagree strongly with most of her decisions and with most of her worldviews. I think I would have probably not voted for her even today, but I do appreciate the fact that she was an honest, I would say an honest servant of the people that she served, of the people who elected her, which I think is so different from what we're used to seeing today in Israel and in other places around the world. And, you know, everything is so personal now, and it's so hard to believe your leaders in these times. And I think for me, as someone who was born in the 90s, looking at so much footage of Golda talking and just the experience of seeing an Israeli prime minister answering a question on television and getting the sense that she really tells me what she thinks and what she believes. On that basic level, I can still disagree with her, but I very much appreciate and even yearn for this kind of leadership today.
Thank you so much, Udi. We'll come back to you afterwards, but thank you for wonderful answers and for just opening up so many vistas about Golda that we didn't have before.
Thank you.
I'm now turning to Professor Medzini. I will call you Ronnie, as you asked, Professor Medzini.
Right.
And my first question to you is, you were Golda's spokesperson while she was prime minister, but did you have any interaction with her during the early years of her career? For example, when she was Israel's first ambassador to the Soviet Union, its first minister of labor, and its foreign minister for almost a decade. And if so, did she ever voice a desire to lead this country that she loved so much?
Along from Jerusalem, I'll start off by showing you, I don't know if you can see it.
Yes, beautiful.
On the right, on here, there are three ladies. One is Golda, the other lady is my mother. That was taken in 1921.
Yeah.
Here, there's a reunion 50 years after they immigrated to Israel.
Raise it a little bit, Ronnie, raise it a bit.
1971.
Yeah.
And therefore, my mother and Golda met when second grade PS4 in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Two little Jewish immigrant girls whose families have just immigrated to America. Not a word of English, everything Yiddish. And they became lifelong friends until Golda died in 1978.
Wow.
And therefore, in many respects, Golda was a sort of a benevolent aunt to myself. I'm told that I met her for the first time in 1934. I was then 2 years old. I don't remember. But I do remember many, many visits to her home, she coming to my parents' home, a lot of discussions. And later on, I was privileged to work in the office of the prime minister. I started my career under Ben-Gurion and then Eshkol. And then Golda inherited me and finally took me on as a spokesman. I want to say one word about the documentary. It's a first-class documentary, even though I participate in it. But it should never give the impression that this is what Golda did. The documentary deals with the last 6 years of her life, which, by the way, were not the best in a very long career. Which spanned about half a century. She began her public career in 1922, and that went on virtually until the end, 1977, 1978, which included the leadership position in the trade union movement and then minister to Moscow. Well, we shouldn't forget she raised $100 million in 48 in order to purchase arms for the National State of Israel. Her main legacy to this very day, a series of labor laws, social security, housing, immigration in the formative years of Israel. It's extremely difficult times and difficult years. She called it her seven best years. And then she became foreign minister, 10 years. I think the two main achievements during those years was the opening to third world, to African nations, and the cementing of special relationship with the United States. When she became prime minister, her achievements were behind her, not ahead of her. When she became prime minister, she was 71. At this age, you don't change. In other words, views, positions, attitudes that you held for decades, extremely difficult to change them. And therefore, she was seen as rigid, inflexible, set in her mind. Part of it, absolutely true. And that was probably her tragedy, that she became prime minister at the tail end of a long career. Now, she was a woman of enormous contradictions. On outside, she was the rock of power, authority. She exuded enormous inner strength. But she was also beset by self-doubts, by sense of inadequacy, lack of proper education. She had 2 years of teacher's training seminar, and this weighed very heavily on her. Her command of Hebrew was not good. The language in which she could express herself the best was Yiddish. Speeches were written for her. She did not do her speeches. She never kept diaries. She rarely wrote articles, let alone books. And therefore, there is also an enormous sense of inadequacy. She was also a very ambitious woman. From very early age, she decided she is going to move ahead. Basically, she asked herself a simple question: what can a little Jewish girl growing up in America aspire to be? A teacher, a seamstress, a sales clerk in some department store, stenographer, what could she do? And therefore, her answer was, the answer taken, by the way, by quite a few Israeli leaders: we're going to build a new society, we're going to build a new country. In the process, we will build ourselves, we will advance ourselves. And this is exactly what she did. And she was very successful at it. So my own memories of Golda, I have tons of stories to tell. Some of them I put into my book, others I refrained from. From my own personal perspective, when I became her spokesman, I asked her, what are the instructions? She said, two instructions. The first is, don't lie. In Hebrew, al tishaker. I said, no, that's obvious. She said, it's not that obvious. The second thing she said, listen, while we're in the office, only with the people from the inside, you can call me Golda. When there are outsiders, it's either Mrs. Meir or Prime Minister. And I have very, very fond memories of this woman, maybe because of her failures, maybe because of her difficulties. She was a very sick woman. The story in Israel was any medical student who wanted to pass his exams had to reel off Golda's ailments. He would get his degree. And she was a very brave woman. And she knew how to suffer her ailments for many, many years. An amazing personality. And I think finally, 42 years after her death, many Israelis are beginning to appreciate. The thing that history has swung around, and they begin to appreciate a bit more. Not so when she was prime minister.
I think one of the things you've mentioned, or one of the one of the issues that you've discussed, is this lack of self-confidence that is actually not unusual among women who reach high positions, because I think we've all been conditioned over the years to feel that this is very much a patriarchal system that we live in, no matter which country you live in. So if you are a woman and you achieve a huge position, you never really feel quite confident or quite right, because somebody, generally a man, is going to make you feel ridiculous, or you're going to allow him to make you feel inadequate. And that is something I think that women have been fighting for a long time. Ronnie, you kind of answered part of my second question in your first question, but let me just ask you, you know, as you said, she comes across in the documentary as inflexible, harsh, and forceful, but there was a mention of her having a softer side. And from your personal interaction with her, what kind of different attitude did she have, not only to you, but for example, regarding her children and her grandchildren? Because she had children and she had grandchildren, and she was a mother and a grandmother, and you can't take that away from her at all.
No, you can't. But she was a single parent.
Yes.
From choice.
Yes.
From choice. She married the man she loved. She, poor man, she dragged him to Israel. She dragged him to a kibbutz, the two ideas he hated. But he was in love with her. He decided to come along. They had two children. They never divorced. They lived apart, but they never divorced. She had her own friends, he had his friends, and she effectively raised their two children alone. And there were certain years in which she knew abject poverty in Jerusalem. And therefore, she understood the needs of working women, of working mothers, of single parents. She knew what poverty meant, and all this later on went into her labor legislation. I would say something else. She was a very kind woman. She could be mean to some of her colleagues, but when it came to family, when it came to assistants, when it came to bodyguards, when it came to the policeman who stood guard outside her building and she used to bring him coffee and tea and sandwiches and so on, she was a model of magnanimity, enormous charm. She had enormous charisma and she had enormous charm, and she knew how to use both. And therefore, it was a pleasure working under this personality, because you knew that you were in touch with a historic figure. In America, there's enormous admiration for her because she was known as the school teacher from Milwaukee who became the prime minister of Israel. She was never a school teacher in Milwaukee, but never mind. But people knew less about her ideals and her policies. I want to, I'll explain what I mean by mean to some of her colleagues. We had a foreign minister called Iban, who, by the way, was born in Cape Town, who was probably the finest orator in the English language for years. She disliked him intensely. After she resigned, some people were sitting in her office and somebody came and said, "Golda, did you hear? Iban wants to be prime minister." She looked at him and she said, "Of which country?" In other words, she put him down right there. There was another Israeli politician who once argued, "Golda has a vocabulary of 500 words. Why does she insist on using 300 words? So she stopped greeting him. She stopped saying shalom to him. And he was insulted and he came to her and said, "Why aren't you saying shalom to me?" She said, "I have so few words. Why should I waste precious words on you?" Oh, she could be very, very, very vicious when she put her mind to it. Look, the key thing is when she was prime minister, and I don't know if I was able to convey this in the documentary, she looked upon this job as a caretaker prime minister. Mm-hmm. No experiments, no tests. I'm not going to rock the boat. I have an office to fulfill. Let me get through with it in a nice, dignified manner. Her major regret was that she did not follow her intuition and resign when she intended to resign. And that was after the elections of October 1973. I sat in on an interview she gave an Italian journalist. She said, "Enough is enough. I'm 75. I've done my duty. After the next elections, I am out, out, out." Then came the war. And before that, she was persuaded to come back. And then came the war. And we remember her because of the war. I'll tell you another story regarding that war. In the documentary, you can see our trip to Sinai. He went to visit the troops before going to America. And she was sitting there and somebody brought her something to drink and so on. It was deep inside Egypt. And as we were about to return home, a soldier shouted to her, Golda, Tihi Chazaka, be strong. And she looked at him and she said, Gam leze en li koach, I don't have the energy for that. In other words, she understood the limits of how much she could do. But during those days, if we had to have a Yom Kippur war, thank God she was the leader of Israel at the time.
I have one more question for you at the moment, Ronnie, but a brief answer, if you don't mind, because we don't really have that much time left. Something that really concerned me. It came up in the video that she hated the belief, repeated often, that Ben-Gurion called her, quote, the only man in the cabinet. Apparently she doubted that he'd said that, but even if he had, she questioned what it meant. Did it mean that it was better to be a man than a woman? And then we hear about Golda's kitchen. Who called it that, and what do you remember most about it? So this was something that stuck with all of us watching the documentary.
He never called her that. In fact, he was very impressed with her, and at some point he said, when the history of Israel will be written, she would be remembered as the woman who made the state possible because of the fundraising she did in 1948. She hated that expression. She said, men like it, I don't. She was not a feminist. She was not interested. She started her career in a women's organization and she didn't like it. She wanted to live, operate, fight in a men's world. And this is basically the way she was treated. Now, kitchen cabinet. This was, in fact, Golda's National Security Council. On Saturday night at her official residence in Ben Maimon Street, Jerusalem, 6-7 cabinet members, all of them Labour Party. Dayan, Iban, Yigal Alon, Justice Minister Shapiro, some of the leading aides would get together and discuss what's going to happen tomorrow in the cabinet session. At least we should present a unified front. No stenography was taken. The only something written was decisions that were achieved. And this is why she enabled people to speak out their mind, because they didn't speak for history. They spoke to the point. And this became known as Golda's kitchen. By the way, it was not in the kitchen. It was in the living room. But the living room was about 2 meters from the kitchen. It is true, she prepared the coffee. I attended one or two of these sessions and I watched it very carefully. It helped clarify her mind. It helped her make decisions. And if there is something that Golda was good at, she made decisions.
You have such amazing memories, but you also have an incredible memory yourself, Ronnie. I mean, to have remembered all those things after having served as spokesperson for 3 prime ministers, I think it's amazing. I think in your head, if anyone had to scratch through, it would take them many decades to sort out all these amazing memories. So thank you so much for that. And thank you for your phenomenal participation in the documentary. It was really a privilege to be able to watch you in the documentary. I will come back to you as well later, but my last panelist is Gusti. Are you there, Gusti? Gusti Braverman. And Gusti, I'd like to start off by saying, as I mentioned when I read your CV, that you are one of only 2 women on the World Zionist Association Executive Committee. You hold an eminent and an extremely important position both in Israeli society and in numerous NGOs. And this August being Women's Month, you are part of this eminent panel because of who you are and who you represent. I've got 2 questions for you to begin with. Have you ever been the victim of gender discrimination? And if so, what, if any, was your reaction and your response? Obviously, not mentioning anyone by name if it occurred, but have there been any incidents since you've been there?
Hi, good evening. It's fascinating for me to listen to the piece of history that I actually faced as a young child, and I have a personal connection to Golda, because being a soldier in the Israeli army, when you were recruited, you got Golda's shoes. It was something that each soldier in Israel knows to wear. Golda's shoes were very unfashionable. It was not a synonym to not being fashionable, but still she has a very, very important brand in the Israeli history. So this, I agree to what people were saying here about how we face Golda today. And I think that we actually miss the kind of leadership that Golda brought with her, being straight ahead, being honest, being courageous, and taking care of her own people. And going back to what you were asking me, being a woman, as you said, I'm one of two in the cabinet, not in the executive, but in the cabinet. We are 13-2, means 50%, while we are 51% in the society. So it says something. And obviously, yes, I did face. And even going back to the first time that I was invited to be part of the executive, a colleague of mine, we shared the same status in the national organization. It was a meeting and it was my first time being there. And when it started, he looked at me and he said, "Would you please take minutes from the meeting?"
Oh.
And, you know, I couldn't even realize What does it mean? But it was a very general issue. And somebody even, it was another colleague of mine, a man, said, "I wouldn't tolerate this kind of behavior." So for me, it was the beginning of a journey. It didn't happen again afterwards, but definitely it was shocking. A 21st century still, somebody looks at you and only because you are a woman, ask you to take the minutes. So so going back to this, I want to share with you something on my screen, and it will tell another story. If you look at this picture, it was taken a year ago in South Africa, of course. And I did some research. I put it on the Facebook and asked people to give it a name. So if you look at this picture, it was not that I was the only woman in the room. It was, and even then, it was very clear that everybody was asked. At the end, I was asked to be on this picture. I think that it tells a story. So whenever I will go with a man, it will be almost obvious that he's senior than I am. This is something that sometimes we have here, two of my staff members that at the beginning they couldn't realize what I'm talking about, but eventually it happens. It happens more than once, more than twice. When somebody sees a woman, definitely the reaction or the default will be, the male is senior to the woman. Still, you have to push yourself to be in the front. It is obvious today, if we look at the data, only 13% of the position, the high position, the political, in business arena and others, women are fulfilling them. It says something. Again, if we look at 51, only 13%, it tells the story. It takes a longer journey to a woman to take the position of being not a leader, to be recognized as a leader. And sometimes I do have the sense that if you are quiet and you act like a man, they will not take you necessarily seriously. So it's always a dialogue, because I think, and we saw it under the COVID, women were acting, the leaders of New Zealand and the other, Finland and others, and Germany, the kind of leadership that they showed was different than mine. But again, it is not easy. We are still in the 21st century. The environment is still not very open. You know, people are saying the right things, but at the end of the day, we need to see how people behave. And if still in many committees, I need to remind people to include a woman, one woman in a committee that is formed of 6, 7, 8, and to include one woman, it tells the story that we have a way to do in order to fulfill the kind of society that we want to have. It's not enough to say to speak about equality and having women as men, because the reality shows that it's quite not the way that we want to present it or to even to feel it. I can, you know, the picture that I showed tells the story.
Well, then you must have been quite offended by this statement in the documentary, which said, and I quote, "Perhaps if she was young and pretty, she wouldn't have been taken seriously." I mean, that is, you know, even looking at it today, in order for a woman, you know, and obviously it excludes you and the majority of women, but that feeling that you have that, you know, if you're young and pretty, you're flighty and you can't do anything properly. You know, your brain isn't working correctly. You aren't professional. You know, you're just one of those sort of candy, eye candy wives kind of things. So that must have been quite a difficult statement for you to handle when you were watching the documentary.
You know, this was the unique sentence that I took from the movie when I saw it, watched it last year. And I kept thinking about this. I'm sure at the time that Golda Meir was the prime minister, it was very right. Definitely, it was something very unique that a woman, she was one of the few women that served as a prime minister. Since then, we didn't have a prime minister woman. So it says something. I think things are changing step by step. Because we can see more women that are attractive and they fulfill, positions, high position, political, in the financial and so on. Still, it's an issue. An example that happened to me this week, we had, you know, I assume that even in South Africa, you heard about the horrifying rape that was in Eilat.
Yeah.
And the decision was that the organization will stop for a few minutes, 10 minutes, and stand out and protest against this. And I was asked to say a few words. It was a bougie and another colleague of mine. And the feedback that I got, "You look great. You were the..." So again, this is something that shows it was not about what I said necessarily, but and you know what, in a way, yes, I do like it. I don't want it to disappear. I don't want that people will ignore the way that I look or so, but it cannot be the first sight, the first feedback that I will get about not what I said, but how did I look at that point. So definitely, I think that there is a change. More things are done in Israel about sexual harassment, and sometimes it goes very, you know, it's to the eight edges. So if it before it was you can say whatever you want to a woman. Today, people are more conscious about this. They choose the words. There are in Israel those that are in charge of sexual harassment, but still, I think that women that look good are not necessarily taking as serious as if you were not looking good. So to make it in a general way, we have a way to do
it. Well, then let me, not really a question, a comment to you. This is one of my favorite Golda quotes when I did a whole lot of research on her, and it is as follows. It isn't really important to decide when you are very young just exactly what you want to become when you grow up. It is much more important to decide on the way you want to live. If you're going to be honest with yourself and honest with your friends, if you're going to get involved in causes which are good for others, not only for yourselves, then it seems to me that it is sufficient, and maybe what you will be is only a matter of chance. And that has an implication, I think, on all our lives as women and as men, but particularly on women, given what's happening over the world, you know, across the world now, especially with the increase in gender-based violence and you know, all the associated problems that go with it.
I disagree. I disagree in a way that I'm ambivalent. Let me rephrase it. On one hand, I think that women do have to make their, you know, kind of decide what they want to be, to plan, not to be taken by the waves, just in the direction that somebody else is planning for you. This time are over, that somebody else plans for you, and whatever will be, will be. Que sera, sera is a song of the 60s. It's not relevant anymore. So for me, no, I expect women when they are young to think about their career. Today we know that there is more than one career and they will switch careers, but yes, they need to plan as men do. At the same time, I like what she said about a role model. Whenever I hear somebody that worked with me, a woman, a young woman saying, you are a role model for me because you broke the glass ceiling for us. And when we look up and to see how few, and you know, when we sit sometimes in the you know, whatever event it is, and I'm the only woman, and it's not something that is rare to be the only woman. For me, it's to show that if you want, as Elton said, if you will it, it's not a dream. And it takes planning and it takes to sacrifice, because it's not enough that nobody will make the place for you. This is another thing that it's important for me to say about women. We cannot expect that to be equal to men if we are not willing to work as hard as men. If we are giving up on career while having children, you mentioned I have 3 children. My youngest just finished army after 4 years in the Gaza border. So yes, I raised children. I had a career. It didn't happen. One day I was asked to serve on the national institution. No, it was a decision that I took not to be absent at any point, but to be part of the game. So if you are asking me, on one hand is to be a role model, to give a fair chance to women, but at the same time, I have more than it's even a demand that women will not give up. Not to say it's too hard, I cannot do it, yes, it's just juggling, but I think that this generation is quite different than my generation even was, and it was better than my parent generation, where we shared responsibilities, but we need to be part of the working process to be ready to sacrifice, to be ready to fight. Yes, and going back to Golda, she had to fight to find her own place. Nobody gave it to her on a silver plate. No, she had to fight. She really need, and you know what? Sometimes when you are more assertive than the others, you know, we know how people tend to look at us or to say about us. Not to be afraid of it. Not to be afraid to be criticized, not to be nice. Sometimes it's part of it. If you want to be influential, you need to take the risk, because otherwise nobody will give us this to us. And eventually, this is a decision that each one, and I hope more women, to see more women and that are serving in crucial points in the society everywhere. And even the fact when Israel, at the first Knesset, there were only 12 women member Knesset, and today we have one quarter. Still, there is to fill more, but we're advancing.
Thank you so much, Gusti. Thank you very much. At this point, David is going to introduce, or he's going to show a short appeal video. If you would all just watch this very short appeal. Thank you.
Thank you, Bev. A quick reminder to type any questions you might have for our panelists into the chat while the video is playing. Sorry.
For over 100 years, the South African Zionist Federation has been the bridge between South Africa and Israel, bringing the best of the Holy Land to the beloved country, and vice versa. That's why, during this time of unprecedented corona crisis, the Fed is working tirelessly to access the latest medical technology from Israel, so that we can contribute to the national fight against COVID-19. Just recently, for example, the SAZF partnered with Israeli startup Sanovia Tech to donate cutting-edge medical masks to Hatzolah Medical Rescue. And the Israeli-developed Chagai volunteer food delivery application is being used with great success to facilitate food deliveries within the Jewish community. Meanwhile, the SAZF's flagship program, South African Friends of Israel, is also stepping up to the plate. SAFI is an organization dedicated to creating a united coalition with other religious, cultural and ethnic groups in the interests of building a broader grassroots support base for Israel in South Africa. SAFI's activities include combating BDS and other delegitimization campaigns, hosting events and gatherings for a diverse community of pro-Israel advocates, and supporting public figures, such as the Chief Justice of South Africa, who have come under fire for their views. Now, in this time of pandemic, our friends and supporters need our help. That's why SAFI has been busy organizing food parcels and feeding schemes, offering a much-needed lifeline to thousands of people who are going hungry as a result of the ongoing pandemic. With no jobs, no food, a deteriorating economy, and bitter winter weather, the situation really is dire. So please, let's come together as a community to help the Fed and SAFI keep hunger at bay. You can show your support by making a deposit into our dedicated coronavirus fund. No amount is too small, and every cent we raise will go towards putting food on the tables of our society's most vulnerable members. Make your donation now using these payment details. Be a light unto the nations by making your contribution today. And please, share this video to spread the word about Israeli tech fighting COVID-19. The South African Zionist Federation and South African Friends of Israel, making a difference where it matters most.
Thank you, David. That was extremely meaningful, and I certainly hope that your appeal pays dividends. I've just had a look in the chat button, and unfortunately, it doesn't look as though there are questions from the audience. I just wonder if anybody is going to ask a question. I'm not sure what to do. I have another few questions for the panelists, but perhaps we're a little bit over time. David, what do you think?
Beth, I think let's give people a chance to ask questions. If you have a short question of your own to get the ball rolling, I think that's a good idea.
I do. Let me find something very short and very interesting for
one. Can I weigh in on some of the things that...
Yes, of course you may, with pleasure.
We almost had a woman prime minister in Israel several years ago. Her name was Tzipi Livni. I think she would have made a very good prime minister.
Yes.
Okay. Golda never included a woman in her cabinet. I think she appointed two or three women as ambassadors. Today, half the Foreign Service are women. It did not interest her. She was not into it, and a woman and so on. She became a prime minister not because she was a woman, but she was the senior. She had the experience. She had the international reputation. And above all, she was acceptable. And that would have averted a big struggle between two younger leaders, Diane and Alon. And therefore, she was told 2 years before Eshkol died that she has to prepare herself to become prime minister. My last contribution for this evening. She was always haunted by an enormous struggle, the harsh reality, the needs of the state, the compromises you had to make with your principles, with your values, with your morals, and the ideas on which he grew up. I'll tell you one story and I'll hush up. Golda hated with passion Germany and Germans. And at the time came when Germany and Israel signed diplomatic establishment, diplomatic relations. For years, she said, I hope when the German ambassador presents his credential, I'll either be dead or sick or not in Israel. Well, she was alive and well and in Israel, and he presented his credentials. I stood outside next to the Israeli police band that played the national anthems. It was summer day, short sleeves, and I looked at one of the members of the police band, and there were blue numbers on his arm. He was in Auschwitz. And he started playing the German national anthem, and tears were running down his cheek. He was playing and he was crying. I went back inside and Golda said, no, Maya, what happened outside? I told her the story. And her reaction was, you saw this in the film. She said there was no night in which she could finish a dream. And that for her life essentially was this enormous struggle between the sweet dreams and the hopes and expectations and very harsh reality. This is how I would remember Golda.
I have a question for you, Professor Medzini, that has just come through. And the question is, if Golda was such a strong and dominant person, why did she bow down to Moshe Dayan's insistence that there was no threat to Israel at the start of the Yom Kippur War? Why did she not force her woman's intuition that she knew that the Arab armies were mobilizing on Israel's borders?
No, the one thing is wrong with that question. It was not Dayan. The man who insisted that there was no danger, or what he called low probability, was the Director of Military Intelligence, General Eli Zaira. This was before the Egyptian informant told Israel, you've got 10 hours to prepare for war. That was the assessment of the IDF, and the Chief of Staff went along. Dayan did not really present a coherent position. One day he said, we have to prepare. The other day he said, we don't have to prepare. You could never know exactly what his feeling was. You're right, or whoever asked the question is right. This was the rare occasion when she did not follow her instincts. Her instincts that day before, I remember she walked like a tiger in her office when news came that the Russians were evacuating civilians. And she said, what do they know that we don't know? And she deferred to the army. Eventually, she imposed on the army mobilization. I think it was about 200,000. Dayan felt 100,000 was enough. Chief of Staff wanted a bit more. But that morning, she realized that things were wrong. And the country paid very heavily for this totally wrong assessment of Egyptian intents, capabilities, and above all, the determination of Egypt to go to war. But she made up with Sadat when she met him.
Yeah, we saw that in the movie. A question for Udi. Udi, in your interaction with the interviewees and indeed in your research on Golda, how would you define her understanding of Zionism?
I would first just like to, with your permission, weigh in on what you just asked Miron, and I think it links to what Gusti was talking about before as well. I think for us, when we looked at this crucial moment where Golda has to take that decision of mobilizing the army, when and how, and the assessment of the war coming, there's a lot of aspects to it, but I think the moment where I understood that there's something wrong with the way Israelis blame everything on Golda, and by everything, I mean, of course, the consequences of that grave war, the moment where when I realized that that's absurd in a way was when I tried to sort of walk her shoes, so to speak, and imagine myself in that situation. And you're talking about a bunch of men, generals, some of the most revered generals, not only in Israel, but worldwide at the time. You know, Moshe Dayan and the other members of the Israeli chief of staff were considered war heroes across the world. And for her, as a 70-plus woman with no military background, to sit in front of them at that moment, and they are her chief of staff and her most top, you know, military advisors, and to tell all of them, all of you are wrong and my intuition is right, I think that is a very tough thing to do, even for a very strong and perseverant woman, or any leader, basically. So I think that that has to do also with gender roles and with her lack of military background. To answer your question, I think Golda saw, and I think Meron can probably weigh in on that better than I do. I would be interested in hearing his view on that as well. But as far as I can see it, Zionism was more or less everything for Golda. Or maybe two things, I would say, Zionism and socialism. Whenever I read through her texts, either in her autobiography or in other speeches and so on, these are the two things that really stand above everything. I think the thing that she wanted most was to have a state here. And then right after that was having that state as a socialist paradise in a way, or, you know, at least a socialist a sincere socialist attempt to really cater the needs of all the people living here. So I think for her, it was above everything, basically. But Meron, what would you say, if I may ask?
You said it even better than I could have said it. I'll just add one more thing. On May 1st, 19, either 49 or 50, I think 50, she marched at the May 1st parade. And she said, socialism in our time. And of course, there's enormous opposition to that. Look, in this area too, she had to make compromises. She understood that Israel's economy will not survive and will not prosper unless you have foreign investments. Who is going to invest in that country? Wealthy American Jewish capitalists. And therefore, you had to make compromises even on this. But her Zionism, and you're absolutely right, was elemental Zionism, Ben-Gurion type of Zionism. A Zionist is one who settles in Israel. Zionism is one who preferably works the land or works physical labor. A Zionist is one who raises his children in a communal settlement. Zionist is one who aspires to see a society based on equality and justice and freedom, and above all on certain values. But here, once again, like every politician in Israel, she had to compromise, and she did that very well. She was wonderful with very wealthy American capitalists, and the amount of money that she was able to raise for Israel over the years, billions of dollars.
I always found that fascinating, I have to say, when I saw how in Israel, Golda was such a dominant figure in the socialist discourse. And then she was able to go to the United States and appeal so effectively to such a different audience where socialism was basically a curse word, you know? So it's fascinating to me.
One of her tragedies was the fact that she could not in any way stop the rot that began to eat into the Labour Party and into the Labour Party movement in Israel, which today is virtually non-existent. And that really started in her time. She was aware of it, but she was powerless to do anything about it.
Gusti, you wanted to say something?
Yes, please. I just wanted to say something that Professor Medzini said about Golda not including women. I wonder if it's by coincidence or it's a typical issue. Because one of the things that I know even today that women do have the tendency to say something about we need to include more women, but to, at the same time to push them aside and away. It's something that I wonder if it was, you know, because she wasn't a feminist or it was something even in the back of her mind. I don't know. But this is something that obviously it is a factor even today about women, how much they embrace other women and they let them flourish next to them or be partners with them. This is a question that I'm leaving here for people to figure out.
I'll give you one answer. The only time Golda failed in an election, she ran for mayor of Tel Aviv in 1955. She was elected to the city council. The city council, because of ultra-Orthodox pressure, refused to vote her in as mayor. Because the ultra-Orthodox, it's not natural. It's against the law of nature of a woman becoming mayor. When she became prime minister, they didn't have much of a choice. But at the time, and that was basically her only setback in 50 years of politics. Israeli society is still governed very much by misinformation, by false tradition, and by a lot of religious animosity towards women.
And as I said in the beginning, it's not only Israel, but the world is very much still a patriarchal world. And women have a huge fight ahead of them, and it's going to last a very long time. I'm going to ask the very last question of Udi, and then we're going to close. Udi?
Bev, I'm sorry to interject, but I do know that Gusti might have to leave.
Yes.
So if we could just thank her, and then we can go on to...
Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you so much. It was a pleasure. Thank you.
Gusti, thank you for what you contributed tonight. It was actually eye-opening and very valuable, and we appreciate it. And the fact that you have that wonderful position in the World Zionist Organization just puts you that much higher on the level of being a top executive. So thank you, and continue with your wonderful work. We so appreciate it.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you very much.
Bye.
Udi, the last question, and I was asked to ask you this. What next project are you working on? Having done this wonderful Golda documentary, what comes next?
We have several projects in parallel right now. The two most advanced ones are, one is about the Israeli Declaration of Independence. It actually has also something to do with Golda. There's also a segment of Golda there, but we're making a film that really tries to, I would say, ask again all the big questions that the Israeli Declaration of Independence tried, but in many ways failed to answer 70 something years ago, and has not really, have not really been answered yet. So that's one thing that we're making that's due around May 2021. And then another film we're making about the coronavirus. And its implication on many different people around the world. It's a sort of collage film of how coronavirus really swinged all our lives into unexpected directions. And that's coming up somewhere in the beginning of 2021.
Well, we do look forward as a South African audience, and a South African audience that is absolutely spellbound by your Golda documentary, to be the first country in which you show your new documentaries. Please, we insist on that. We will open the doors to the rest of the world when you do that for us.
With pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I would just want to give a very warm personal thanks to Professor Medzini. It's been an honor to interview you for the film. You're an unbelievable treasure of knowledge, and your memory is exquisite, and your insights are always fascinating. And I think we're all privileged here again today to be able to hear you. And thank you so much.
Absolutely. Here. Thank you. I want to call on Maxine Boyd now to thank the panelists officially. And a little...
Can I say one thing, Bev, before you go?
You can, Ronnie.
Can I wish all my friends in South Africa Shana Tova?
Ah, thank you.
May it be a better year than the one that is ending.
Alavai.
And to inform you that as a result of the documentary, my son and I are now engaged in filming my own memories of 9 prime ministers.
Wonderful.
Their role in history of Israel. I'll talk to Udi about it when we meet again.
Please do.
Antova, thank you very much.
Before we go, I'm pulling
a sneaky move here. There's a question in the chat that I really would like to hear the answer to, and it's for Professor Medzini. What do you think Golda would think of Israel today? I just want to hear the answer, and then we can go to the closing. Sorry.
In 2 words, you would be horrified.
Really?
I was asked that so many times in so many Q&As, and I've always wondered if I give the right answer, Professor Medzini, and I think now I know. If you feel the same, then I know that I haven't been mistaken. I wonder, for you, what do you think would be the main reasons for that?
I'd rather not go into it because I will need about 30 minutes to explain myself. She would have been flabbergasted. And not only at the ruling party, but at the entire political arrangements that we have in the country now. It's a totally different world.
Sadly.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Ronnie. I'm going to now just call upon Maxine and a very short, brief introduction. Maxine is particularly special because she was the person who suggested holding this exceptional event. She made the initial contacts and followed through on them, and we all owe her a huge vote of thanks for having brought Golda into our lives and our screens. And who exactly is Maxine? You'll hear in a moment. She currently sits on the management committee of the South African Zionist Federation Cape Council. She's the administrator of the JNF desk in Cape Town. And she's also the lay leader for the Dilif Teen Fellows Program in Cape Town. But more than that, Maxine is an integral part of the South African Zionist Fed Cape Town office. She's played an active role in Jewish communal organizations for many years and has a wealth of knowledge about the community. She's a huge asset to the South African Cape Council. She's a cook and baker of note. She's a passionate Zionist and an exceptional Jewish wife, mama, and boba. We're all in awe of her abilities, her skills, and her innate warmth and caring about everyone in her circle. Amen. Maxine, if you would thank our 3 very eminent panelists, thank you very much.
Thanks, Bev, and thanks for the wonderful words that you said about me. Hi, everyone. In South Africa, August, as we all know, is Women's Month. And what a better way to celebrate and acknowledge a prominent woman in Jewish history like Golda Meir, who has been someone that I have always admired, right from a teenager or young woman. I hope that everyone who has, and those who are still to watch the screening of the movie, will be as inspired as I was. There were many aspects of Golda that a lot of people, as we heard, were not aware of. Now to this evening's discussion. I would like to extend grateful thanks and appreciation to the panel, Professor Mayron Medzini, Gusti Braverman, and Udi Nier, all who gave us much insight into this remarkable woman, and of course to our wonderful host, Bev Goldman, who I'm going to take this opportunity to wish Mazel Tov on her election as National President of the Union of Jewish Women of South Africa earlier this week.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Other thanks must go to David Fleminger for all the technical back-end work he has done for tonight and all the other events that are run for the South African Zionist Federation. We much appreciate our marketing team of Lisa Peretz of Johannesburg and Yvette Rosenberg in Cape Town. They are the most dynamic team who continue to arrange and bring us so many events, including webinars, interviews with well-known personalities, and brings us much stimulation all the time. I cannot end this evening without mentioning Hedwig Goldschmidt and Adair Taylor Schechter of GoTo Films, who allowed the SAZF to screen the documentary, a movie in South Africa. Hopefully this is the start of a new wonderful working relationship between ourselves. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Maxine. And may I echo Professor Medzini's Shana Tova to everybody listening. It's going to be a very different Shana Tova this year. It's going to be a very different Yom Kippur, but we will get through it. This too shall pass. Fortunately, all of us, I assume, watching and being here tonight are safe and well. And may Hashem bless us all and our families and Klal Yisrael. And thank you on my behalf as well to the three wonderful, wonderful panelists. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for having us and for moderating this event. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thanks.
Good night. Cheers from Jerusalem.
Good night from Haifa as well.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you, everyone. I'm just going to quickly remind you of two upcoming events before we go. The first one is discussing the Israel-UAE deal, insights from behind the scenes with Nir Boms and Haysam Hassanein. I'm sorry if I didn't pronounce that correctly. That's on the 7th of September at 7:30. And we have Iron Dome, a three-part documentary series, the untold story of Israel's miraculous missile defense system. Save the date and look. Check out our Facebook page for more details. And with that, I thank you all and thank you for joining us.